Very happy you could join us. We'll be holding weekly webinars between today, January 21st, and March 18th, 2004. The webinars are hosted, co-hosted by the Great Northern LCC, the Southern Rockies LCC, Plains and Prairie Potholes LCC, and the Great Basin LCC. Those are the four landscape conservation cooperatives that expand across the range of big sagebrush and the greater sagegrass. Now, the LCC Partner Forum concept is to provide a structured approach so that we could collaboratively communicate conservation science, information, tools, activities within large geographies, identify priority science products and information needs that are strategically aligned to meet the needs of specific agency program or partnership outcome based adaptive management processes, and to seek alignment for conservation planning and action among organizations, jurisdictions, and landscapes. Essentially, it's an opportunity for conservation practitioners over very large areas to have a community focused place and to have those important conversations about how we're going to see our natural resources appropriately conserved and managed. For the Sage Step Partner Forum, as many of you probably know because you went to this site to register for this webinar, you can find us at the sites.google.com location here. As I mentioned, we will be hosting a science webinar series each week on Tuesday afternoon at 1 p.m. Mountain Time. That is 2 p.m. Central Time and noon Pacific Time. And as you see here, there's a list of all the presentations we'll be giving each week. Again, the site to register for upcoming webinars is down the bottom. And everything that you, all information that you need for this webinar series, and then to follow up with the Sage Step Partner Forum, will be located on this wiki page. If you look at the February 18th presentation, you'll see that we will have a specific demonstration about how this wiki functions and give everyone an opportunity to engage more deeply using that web resource. Today's presentation is by Matt Germino, a research scientist at the USGS Forest and Rangeland Ecosystem Science Center. We'll hand the floor over to Matt here in just a minute, but I want to let you know that we'll have plenty of opportunity for questions and comments at the end of Matt's presentation. The way that we will handle the questions is by the that pop-out screen that you can get from the right side of your computer screen here, the GoToWebinar command pop-out, and one of the options is to type in a question. You type in questions there, and you can type them at any time during the presentation. I will collect them, and I will answer your questions. I will ask your questions to Matt in the order that they are received. So without any further ado, I hand it over to Matt Germino. And if everyone gives us a minute here, we will switch the presentation to Matt's computer.
Hello, everybody, and thanks very much for the opportunity to present to you today. So I'm Matt Germino, located here in Boise, actually two offices over from Sean Finn, and I'm in the USGS Forest and Rangeland Ecosystem Science Center, and I was hired as a research ecologist on special assignment to serve the Great Basin LCC, and my background is in plant ecology and physiology, and I've been working in the sagebrush steppe ecosystem now for about, I guess, a dozen years. What I would like to do is to describe, the nature of the problems with big sagebrush in particular. There's many other types of sagebrush out there, but we're going to focus primarily on big sagebrush, which is one of the most widely distributed and locally abundant species in the western U.S. across the, and obviously occurs across our LCCs. And I think, as most of you know, there are three subspecies of big sagebrush. The very tall growing basin big sagebrush, Artemisia tridentata, subspecies tridentata. And there's also the subspecies wyomingensis. And it's in this particular subspecies that we're seeing the worst problems in terms of conservation and restoration. And at the higher elevations is mountain big sagebrush. And this diversity is very important to the presentation, so I wanted to give you a little bit of background on that. And there's a lot of interest now in thinking about where the sagebrush steppe ecosystem is going with respect to climate as it relates to our efforts to conserve the habitat type and its dependent species, such as sage grouse, and also in our efforts to restore it following disturbances. And so a large part of my talk will touch on some of the key elements, key problems related to restoration. And I want to make a point before I get too much further that that is related to USGS policy. I know this presentation will be shown online. All data, unless I've given a citation, are preliminary. And so if anybody would like to use these data, please contact me beforehand. These images portray a vulnerability, climate vulnerability assessment for Artemisia tridentata published by Daniel Schlafer and colleagues. And these types of vulnerability assessments are increasingly common, and they're being used to help us get a fix on what we might be able to expect at the eco-regional level for changes in sagebrush. Here is an example of one that's recently come out in the Central Basin and Range Rapid Ecological Assessment that I think many of you are probably familiar with. These species distribution models are generated using the bioclimatic envelope approach, which requires a lot of assumptions, but is generally produced by looking at relationships of where the subject species occurs relative to different climates, and then mapping forward how that climate space for the species changes under future climate scenarios. So here, for example, the RIA is showing us that in the Central Basin and Range, the blue areas would be where we might expect big sagebrush to be lost from the landscape in a climate projected out to 2060, or where we might see some expansion. And we're very interested in thinking about the vulnerabilities and the uncertainties also in our assessments. I want to point out before I get too much further that the paleoecological record is another way of looking at the vulnerabilities of sagebrush. This is a record derived from pollen collected from sediments in cores. And here, for example, under Rattlesnake Cave, if you go back 15,000 years, a period in which climate, first of all, warmed progressively since deglaciation, but then secondly, varied wildly between cold and dry periods or cold and wet. And you can notice that Artemisia sagebrush pollen is present throughout this period. Meanwhile, lots of other species assemblages are coming and going. And what this tells us is that over paleoecological time, that sagebrush has actually had it's endured quite a bit of climate variability. Now our landscape is changing appreciably due to other stressors and drivers. For example, here's a image that I got from GeoMac online that shows all of the areas burned in the Northern Great Basin during 2012. It's something like 3 million acres. And you can see, and I know all of you are aware of this, that fires not only have become more frequent, but they've also become much larger in size. And sagebrush is, number one, not very well adapted to fire, but secondly, and more importantly, it's really poorly adapted to very large and frequent fires. Sagebrush is an obligate cedar, which means that it can't reestablish from meristems that might be buried below soil and therefore might survive fires. And that's particularly problematic when you consider also that its seeds, which are very small, are short-lived. They're generally perceived to be viable only for about 3 years, although we've been surprised at some of our seed collections. We've gotten germination well after 3 years. Furthermore, seed dispersal distances are very small for big sagebrush. So when you have a large fire, such as the long draw Holloway complex, where you can have many dozens of miles burned with no surviving sagebrush in between, if there's not good sagebrush establishment in the first few years after fire, then there's a pretty good chance that for the subsequent decades, there will also not be much sagebrush present. And it's for this is one of the reasons for the very intensive sagebrush seeding or planting efforts that are occurring after fires now. In fact, what I've learned while working in the Department of Interior is that one of the largest investments into conservation in the Great Basin is actually the post-fire seeding and rehabilitation investments. Unfortunately, a lot of the seedings haven't been very successful. And so now we're beginning to ask why, and can we fix some of these things? Certainly, climate variability is very important, but there's also questions about the different seed sources or restoration techniques that are being used. Probably there's areas for improvement, and these areas may also be key ways that we can adapt to climate shifts in the future. Large fire sizes are causing other emergent problems, such as the specter of massive wind erosion. This lower photo here shows my hand next to a pedestaled stump of a perennial bunch grass. And you can see a lot of the roots are exposed because the soil has been swept away. This is from a site that occurred near Idaho Falls. And certainly all of the sagebrush seed that had been stored or banked on this site for the many years prior to burning, that seed is probably long gone, blown perhaps as far as the Tetons. And the 100,000 acres that this fire occurred on now certainly should be experiencing a deficit of sagebrush seeds. And in fact, I have been monitoring this site since it burned in 2010, and I've not seen a single sagebrush seedling on it. And so these are other factors that we need to keep in mind that greatly affect the restoration template that we're trying to work with. So much of the literature on sagebrush responses to climate are based on adult plants. However, in this new landscape, which has a much greater occurrence of disturbances, we also need to be thinking about seed and seedling establishment as key processes underlying resilience, both as it occurs naturally as well as how we augment it in restoration. And so I'm going to present a little bit on some new findings related to sagebrush seedlings. So let's begin with some climate responses of sagebrush that I'm most familiar with because this is research that I've led. And I chose to focus on this because the LCCs have been a major motivating factor for us to, number one, continue these experiments, but also to expand them and try to make them more relevant. And so we've received funding from the Northwest Climate Science Center, as well as the USGS, and more recently we've had some support for in the name of the LCCs for this. Key questions are, simply, how does sagebrush respond to shifts in the amount and timing of precipitation and also to warming? And this kind of experimental information, although to many of you it may seem, the relevance of it may seem compromised by the fact that we're going to be talking about small plot scale studies, I do think it's important because otherwise most of the way that we make inferences about climate relations is from just observing where species occur relative to different climate patterns. But it's important to keep in mind that there's a whole host of confounding factors there. We all know that cross elevation gradients from relatively warmer deserts to deserts like those occurring in the basins of Teton National Park shown here, but there's also gradients of disturbance. And even more importantly, from my perspective, there's gradients in species adaptation. Like, we know that mountain big sagebrush has organismal traits and ecophysiological traits that affect the way it grows and the way it competes with neighboring herbs and how it responds to climate. And those differ greatly from Wyoming big sagebrush. And therefore, I believe it's important to try to isolate the effects of warming and temperature, to try to see to what extent these ecosystems are able to resist progressive changes in climate, or how quickly will they respond and how will they respond. So I'll focus on two different studies. One is located on the Idaho National Lab, and it's where we have our precipitation treatments. And then the second spans the whole Snake River plain from the headwaters of the Teton, the Snake River down towards Boise near the Oregon border. There's some differences amongst these treatments and some similarities. The key similarities are in the types of things that we've measured, such as cover, density of plants, height, etc. And before I get too much further in this, I should note to you that although I'm focusing a lot on just the sagebrush responses, by no means do we think that restoration of and conservation of sagebrush habitats is just about sagebrush. The associated bunch grasses, herbs, and soil crusts are also very key things to consider. However, big sagebrush is most definitely a foundation species, and its presence on the landscape has a huge effect, we've shown, on the abundance and diversity of all the surrounding taxa. And in future presentations or publications, we'll show the balance of a more comprehensive look at the whole community responses to climate shifts. So here at the Idaho National Lab, we have a large study that you can see here in this Google Earth image, which for several decades now has manipulated the amount and the seasonality of precipitation. And the seasonality of precipitation in particular is really important because there's a lot of disparity in climate projections as to whether or not we're going to get more or less precipitation. However, there's more consistency in amongst projections in that that when we get precipitation is likely to shift. So how important is the seasonal timing of precipitation? Well, we've tested this across very large plots that are outlined here in these pipes that deliver irrigation onto these long-term plots. Plots are either receiving no supplemental precipitation or a doubling of annual precip added either in the wintertime or in the summer. And on top of this, we've planted these plots either with a native mix of sagebrush steppe species, perennials, or with a monoculture of crested wheatgrass. Crested wheatgrass is a very common species used in restoration, probably in all four LCCs, but most certainly in this area in the Northern Great Basin. At this particular site, crested wheatgrass seems to be fairly invasive, and it's colonized areas where we haven't planted it and become the dominant plant. The third factor here is that we've got different soil types. So soils vary considerably across the Great Basin, and the domain of the sagebrush habitat type. We have shallow and deep plots. I'll focus on those. Additionally, we have plots that have different kinds of stratigraphy, and I won't get into data from those. This is a valuable experiment in my mind, and it's one in which we can test some of the key hypotheses about how sagebrush responds to climate. So first, let me explain this graph. This is a typical climate diagram. Temperature on the x-axis that goes with the dashed line here. And on the right is precipitation scaled 20 millimeters per 10 degree increment in temperature, and precipitation is shown in the solid line. The hatched areas here show where we think there's a net gain of moisture by the ecosystem, and therefore soil water storage can occur. The stippled area in the middle of summer is when there's a net deficit of water and when water's lost from the system. And this is a really key point. Most of the growth of sagebrush and other perennials occurs when growing season temperatures are favorable, yet when water balance is at a net deficit. And so that means that a lot of the theory is that a lot of the growth of the perennials in sagebrush is occurring using water that's been stored during the times of years when temperatures are too cold and evapotranspiration is inhibited. Our two treatments either increase the amount of summer precipitation like this, or they increase the precipitation during the cool season and thereby allow infiltration to the deeper soil horizons. During the summertime, this precipitation added, you might expect it to either be evaporated quickly from the soil, or grasses, which tend to have relatively shallow and fibrous root systems, might quickly use that soil water, and it might not have the opportunity to infiltrate deeper in the soil. The soil depth thing is really important for sagebrush because one of its unique features is that it has both shallow as well as deeper taproots. And those deep taproots are distinct from most of the perennial herbs or exotic herbs like cheatgrass that it would compete with. So a long-standing hypothesis that relates to these ideas comes from Heinrich Walter, who was one of the first major geographers, plant geographers, and he hypothesized for semi-arid ecosystems like the sagebrush steppe type that we're dealing with, that the coexistence of shrubs and grasses is made possible by this winter precipitation, which infiltrates deep into the soil and selectively benefits sagebrush. And if this is true, it's handy because it kind of helps us think a little bit more resolutely about climate shifts as they relate to changes in the types of plants and shallow, deep-rooted, early season plants, late season plants. All of those should affect the water available to sagebrush. And so we've been focusing on these ideas and testing them. Now, I want to emphasize that this bilayer hypothesis has really been evaluated mainly by looking at where roots are in the soil. So if plants have deep roots, then people assume that, well, that deep soil water must be important to the species. Or they might do things like add isotopically labeled water to deep soils. And if they see those isotopes end up in the stem and foliage, then they would assume that the plant has used the water and therefore that deep water source might be important. We reasoned that a much more sound type of evidence would be to simply apply deep or shallow water, as we've done, and observe how the species responds at the population level while it's competing and growing with neighboring species. And here's an example of some very recent data that we have provisional acceptance to publish in Journal of Ecology. And here what you can see on shallow and deep soils is the total population shrub cover on these very large plots. So these are 64 meter squared plots, pretty large in the domain of experimental ecology. And on deep soils, it's not very surprising that the solid symbols here, which represent plots with winter precipitation, have a lot more sagebrush cover than do plots that received no precipitation or those that had summer precipitation. Summer precipitation, this increase is not even significantly, it's not even significant. This is consistent with the hypothesis we just framed. But what was very surprising to us was that an almost opposite effect happened on these shallow soils. Here you can see the plots that had that extra precipitation added in the wintertime actually saw they had less sagebrush than did plots that were irrigated in the summer or in the winter. And actually, since these data in 2011 were collected, we've seen an even further decline in sagebrush. So this is this finding is requiring us to kind of rethink the hypothesis that that actually sagebrush doesn't simply grow more with more deep water, that it actually has an Achilles heel, so to speak, and that there's a trade-off. It's highly adapted to making do with dry soils, and perhaps as a compromise, when soils become saturated because they are, number one, shallow, but number two, getting a lot of more winter precipitation, which, by the way, I've seen some forecasts to that effect, that we might see more of a precip in the winter, that the saturation of soils might do things, something like create an anoxic condition, which inhibits sagebrush. And at first, this was hard for us to wrap our heads around because it's not obvious on the landscape that such a mechanism could be working. But since then, we've talked a lot with people around the region, and they've shown us flood patterns in this closed basin that, you know, the Big Lost River drains into this area. And indeed, if you look on satellite imagery, a lot of the depressions in this region do not have much in the way of sagebrush. So here you can see an example of where the experimental data is providing a key insight that we normally wouldn't have gleaned from just observing sagebrush in its natural condition. Another interesting finding was when we did some statistical modeling, we found that shallow soil moisture is a much more important predictor of the abundances of sagebrush than deep soil water, aside from the fact that we see these deep soil effects. So sagebrush is happier in deep soils, but when you get to fine-tuning your predictive ability, surprisingly, shallow soil moisture is pretty important. And again, that kind of contrasts the basic theory. And also, from what I can tell, I'm not a species distribution modeler, but I have tried to read and understand these papers in addition to the theory, and I'm pretty sure that these types of trade-offs aren't something that's being considered right now. And they enter another element of uncertainty in what these vulnerability assessments are predicting for us. I wanted to show you a little bit more of how some of these other species are responding. For now, I'll just leave a teaser that we see that cheatgrass has some similarities in how it's responding to our experimental increases of winter precipitation. Cheatgrass is almost extinguished from sites where we have doubled the summer precipitation. And as you all know, cheatgrass is a major driver of fire, and fire strongly affects sagebrush. And so we hope to evolve our perspective at the whole community level like this. Another very relevant line of research extension here is that the jackrabbits on this site are having a tremendous effect on the sagebrush. Some sagebrush have been entirely girdled and killed by the rabbits, such as in the spring of 2011, a major snow year. The hungry rabbits girdled the sagebrush at the top of the snowpack. And they appear to have done this more on plots that receive no extra precipitation compared to those that are getting more precipitation, especially in the wintertime. So these shrubs are not only bigger, but they appear to be better defended against herbivores, and probably they could also possibly be less palatable. That's another thing to consider, because when we restore sagebrush to the landscape, oftentimes we're motivated by enhancing or conserving habitat for game species or for wildlife. And so these changes in palatability or vulnerability to herbivores are probably pretty important to keep in mind, and they do change. By the way, I forgot to mention that this INL site has become totally dominated by basin big sagebrush. So these results are for basin big sagebrush. Now I'm going to shift gears and talk about nighttime temperatures and warming. So warming, particularly at night, is one of the surest climate trends that we have occurring. The greenhouse effect primarily increases long-wave radiation. balances, and long wave radiation has its biggest effect on the temperatures of soils and plants at night. And we've devised a technique to cheaply and passively increase long wave radiation. And we've set up experiments in the basins of Teton National Park near Twin Falls and down here near Boise in the Birds of Prey National Conservation Area. Our technique, again, increases long wave radiation using clear plastic, and that the configuration here of these open-sided chambers allows precipitation as well as sunlight through, but it increases the long wave radiation by about 75 watts per meter squared, which you could relate to the energy in a light bulb. And that leads to a couple degrees of warming of the soil surfaces and the plant surfaces, which is very similar to what we might predict about 50 to 100 years out from now. So these provide a very realistic type of warming, aside from the fact that they're small, relatively small chambers, and so there's edge effects and things like that that are problematic for when I go to interpret the results. At places like Birds of Prey, using the collaborations that we've developed with Anna Halford and colleagues, we've been able to greatly expand these experiments and replicate them across the landscape. So here you can see about a 5 mile gradient south of Boise towards the Snake River, where we've got different areas burned in 2012. Well, we were able to establish these warming frames, control frames, and through a UI, University of Idaho, collaborator Alex Suazo, also these rainout shelters. Here's a combination of warming and rainout. We set these up both in burned and unburned areas. And this was also made possible by grants from the Great Basin Native Plant Selection and Increase Project and from the USGS Northwest Climate Science Center. The main results, one of the most interesting results rather, across this gradient from Boise to our sites near Twin Falls towards Teton National Park, has been that the growth responses of sagebrush, in terms of the incremental length of growth of stems, are much more responsive to warming at the highest elevations compared to the lower elevations. I should note here, very important point, that at Teton National Park we're actually working on little sagebrush and not big sagebrush. However, we hope to get mountain big sagebrush instrumented and part of this experiment up here soon. So this is a very interesting finding, and it's not particularly matching what we would have predicted from the species distribution models, several of which show that this Birds of Prey National Conservation Area might be poised to see a reduction in sagebrush with warming. At some sites, like the Tetons, we've also thrown in manipulations of snowpack. Snowpack is perhaps one of the most important components of the climate system for sagebrush. Snow insulates sagebrush from winter minimum temperatures and provides an important source of moisture. Interestingly here, compared to the green control, you can see, again, the heating has a very large effect, but snow removal has an even more effect, a greater effect, and the combination of adding heat while you remove snow has the greatest effect. And these patterns all make good sense if you think back to that climate diagram. The climate diagram that I showed before emphasizes how important the overlap of temperatures with the temporal overlap of growing season temperature with moisture is really the most important thing. Our climate assessments tend to focus mostly on things like average temperatures or total annual precipitation. However, our experiments are showing us that those variables actually, it might not be very useful in helping map out what could happen with sagebrush under different climate shifts. Also at this site, very interesting to think about how the climate responses of little sagebrush might either prevent or open up the ability of mountain big sagebrush at the next lower elevations to move into these sites, things that we're thinking about. So the species distribution models show, as I showed before, they show a lot less. They show a lot less expansion than contraction. We're not necessarily seeing that when we test specifically for the effects of warmer nights. We've also looked at other demographic variables like reproduction, both flowering, seed output, and also seedling establishment patterns. Here for little sagebrush, again, you can see an example of how warming is causing a major increase in flowering. It's not too surprising to us considering the importance of the cool season for reproduction. Sagebrush does a lot of its flowering and seeding late in the fall. And that's when minimum temperatures can be very low. Daytime temperatures might be perfectly optimum, but nighttime temperatures are typically very close to 0 Celsius. And so a little bit of warming can go a long way, apparently. Again, these are preliminary data. We've been very surprised when we looked at seedling establishment to see, number one, very little seedling establishment across any of the sites except for where we have basin big sagebrush at the Idaho National Lab. Our other sites are near Twin Falls, a Wyoming big sagebrush site that hasn't burned in many years. And the birds of prey area, you know, again, we've looked at both at burned and unburned areas. The unburned areas hadn't burned for at least 10 to maybe something like 50 years. And the understory is chock full of either cheatgrass or has a healthy mix of native perennials and crusts. So this right here, seedling establishment, remains an enigma to us. Unfortunately, we don't feel very well parameterized to say much about how natural seedling establishment is affected by our climate treatments. So from these climate experiments, minimum temperatures and the amount and timing of precipitation are pretty important. These warming effects appear to be more pronounced in the cooler regions. Now, if I have shown climate experiments for particular sagebrush types, now what I'm going to do is, in a sense, undermine the whatever transferability or generalizability that we might have perceived from previous experiments by telling you that sagebrush is exceptionally diverse in ways that we continue to be surprised by. And this is work that I'm doing with Bryce Richardson, who has been hired by the Forest Service to replace Durant MacArthur. Durant MacArthur, of course, had a long-time pioneering research program that revealed the genetic and psychological diversity of big sagebrush, and introduce the concepts of how we could have hybrids of between the different subspecies occurring in very complex ways across gradients. And his work was done on the foothills near Provo, Utah. This is a photo showing a common garden established by Bryce, shown here, and Nancy Shaw and others. They established three of these from seeds collected from all over the western United States of all three subspecies, Wyomingensis, Basin, and Mountain Big Sagebrush. They collected about 20 populations from each subspecies and had good replication for each plant per garden. Planted them as, I can't remember, 1 or 2 year old individuals into gardens that had lots of herbicide and were well irrigated and were pretty well cultivated to allow these guys to establish. And one garden was done near Boise in a site type that normally grows both Wyoming and Basin big sagebrush. Okay, that's up here. And then in Ephraim, near central Utah, at low elevations in a valley bottom, another garden was established in a site that would normally support Basin big sagebrush. And then just uphill from there is a mountain big sagebrush site that has the full garden planted. So three gardens. And I want to show just one snippet of data. I'm not going to show you a comprehensive look at the results from this, but there's a couple of things I want to point out. First is what's shown on this x-axis. So tri, wyo, and vas, these are the subspecies. Tridentata is basin, wyomingensis, and then vasayana is mountain big sagebrush. Diploids, which means two genome copies, or tetraploid. And Bryce has recently published a paper in American Journal of Botany, which in some ways shatters or shakes up our perspective on the taxonomy of big sagebrush. And his data, which were done from pyrosequencing, like high throughput genetic analyses, suggested that a phylogenetic or an evolutionary history pattern in which early on there was mountain big sagebrush at the higher elevations, diploid basin big sagebrush at the lower elevations. Each of these had an autopolyploidy event, which gave rise to tetraploids of each subspecies. So here's the tetraploid for Vastiana. And then wyomingensis tetraploid has been spun off of the tetraploids from either the basin or the mountain big sagebrush. The implication is that there's probably lots of ways in which Wyoming big sagebrush has originated in terms of its evolution, and that has a huge effect on the diversity within this. Now here what you can see is that if we plot out the a parameter, this is somewhat of just a nominal thing that I picked to show you, the abundance of ephemeral leaves. So these long leaves right here that have frost on them, by the way, these are the ephemeral leaves which sagebrush grows. And here also you can see much shorter leaves which are perennial. These ephemeral leaves enable rapid growth, but they're typically shed during midsummer drought. And here what you can see is that when we tried to look at differences in either the abundance of ephemeral leaves or in the size of plants since planting, we can explain a lot more of the variability if we think about not just the differences in subspecies, but also whether or not they are diploid or tetraploid. And this suggests that there's an underlying diversity that doesn't meet the taxonomic eye when we look at the traits that we use, the traits such as plant height or leaf morphology that we usually use to distinguish these species in the field. And instead, there's important functional differences that really need to be considered when we try to look at big sagebrush across the landscape. Here's another type of data that shows some interesting patterns. Water use efficiency. So drought and heat, probably pretty important for a desert species like big sagebrush. It's reasonable to expect that there could be a lot of adaptation for better or perhaps relaxed water use efficiency based on where these different species tend to occur across the landscape. So here I've determined water use efficiency using carbon isotopes. That's not important for now, but what is important is to note that that there's some differences, and the differences kind of match this trend from the diploid mountain or the diploid basin in towards the tetraploid wyomingensis. Notice the small amount of variability, though, between all these different sagebrush types. That's very small compared to, brace yourself, this this variability. Here what I'm showing you, and please don't get lost in the details on this, but here what I'm showing you is the amount of variability between the populations within the diploid basin big sagebrush or Wyoming big sagebrush or the tetraploid mountain big sagebrush. And if you can recollect back to the previous slide, there was much less variability across all these five groups than there is just within the diploid basin big sagebrush. So really significant, tremendous variability within a subspecies and even within a subspecies ploidy combination. In other words, the local population variability, the inherent population variability, is very high in big sagebrush. And that's problematic when it comes to picking seed sources. When you have a huge fire in a big year in which seed sources are rare, and you, and as a land manager, you might not have local seed sources to draw upon for seeding an area that you think needs to have some sagebrush seeding or planting. A lot of times, I sense that it's typical for us to try to use the most local seed sources, and I think that's probably good rationale. We've tried to see whether or not there's evidence that local is better in our data. And I'm showing here a graph that I can make simple for you that shows data collected as of last summer. There's been some recent updates that will revise what's shown here. But for now, I want to point out that the leftmost bars are the Boise Garden, which again is a basin and a Wyoming Ancestors type of garden site. Ephraim, which is a basin big sagebrush site, and then over here we've got the mountain big sagebrush site. If local seed is better, then we might expect the provenances that are local, shown in the solid, to have greater survivorship or height or perhaps water use efficiency than distant seed sources, shown here in the open bars. And we saw some situations where that's occurring, okay? And a lot of other situations where we saw either the opposite or no evidence one way or the other. So not a very strong indication for survivorship, for a local adaptation. In fact, for some situations, we saw that the species, the provenances, regardless of where they're from, love to go better, or they like to have greater survivorship and growth when grown at the highest elevation garden. So one of the needs, to my understanding, for land management is to have guidance for seed transfer. If you have a million-acre fire, what constitutes appropriate seed? How far away can it come from, and how distant or different of a climate system can it be transferred in from? The data that I just showed testing the local adaptation hypothesis is one way to look at it. aside from whether or not we see local adaptation, we can ask, do populations differ in their climate adaptedness as a function of the climate of origin? And if that's true, then we should see traits like survivorship, or again, in this case, water use efficiency, differing, number one, differing across among the provenances, but then number two, having some sort of relationship in which their differences relate to the climate of origin. And if we see strong trends here, then the case for seed zones will be increased. Well, interestingly, at the Boise Common Garden, thus far, I know my colleague Bryce has revised this a little bit, and he has some brand new information that may change things, but thus far we really struggled to find strong relationships. Here, for example, I had to look to the tetraploid populations, and when I correlated the warmth of the climate of origin for those seed sources against water use efficiency, I got a significant relationship, but a low amount of variability explained only. So this kind of surprised us. Where sagebrush habitats are cold desert, and most of the information on climate responses relates to heat and drought, in other words, summertime effects. But the cold part relates to winter. We've been doing a lot to look at winter stress. Here is a measure of photosynthetic resistance. It's derived from measuring chlorophyll fluorescence. And we looked at how the stress level of photosynthesis changed from fall going into winter. And we asked whether or not the variability in this related amongst the provenances related in any way to the temperature of origin. We found that overall, in the dashed line here, yes, there was a relationship, perhaps a stronger relationship than for what we observed with water use efficiency. And when we looked at just particular groups like basin big sagebrush, we saw even stronger and steeper relationships. So this is telling us, these types of analysis are pointing out to us which climate variables we need to focus in on. In this case, winter stress is looking more important than we previously thought. So I've shown mostly information for adult plants, but seedlings, as I mentioned before, are really important when we think about the restoration template, and there's hardly any information on genetic variability and provenance effects for seedling vigor. Martha Brabeck, a student of mine, has shown that the photosynthetic resistance to chilling is fairly equal in adults from local or not local habitats. This is over many populations. But when you look at seedlings, here you see much more evidence for local adaptation. And so it's the seedling stage that we think we really need to be looking at. And indeed, we've been going after this most recently through our collaborations with Anna Halford and others. This table shows a whole range of different provenances and subspecies and the unique characteristics of those populations compared to the birds of prey area. Here we've got some populations from areas that have almost no winter planted in the birds of prey. Here's a population, a basin big sagebrush from Oregon that grows in an area that's warmer and drier than the birds of prey. Interestingly, this plant, this provenance right here is showing the greatest growth, almost double of any of these other populations, including our most local seed sources. However, we do have several other data sets that show survivorship is greater in our more local plants. Sagebrush restoration is usually not done in isolation. Usually a aerial seeding of sagebrush or a hand seeding or a hand planting of sagebrush is done in conjunction with some sort of treatment of the herb layer, such as applying herbicides to reduce invasive exotics, or seeding with a rangeland drill to increase the abundance of perennials, perennial herb forbs or grasses. A lot of times we do fencing to keep out grazers, and mowing to decrease the abundance of fuels for wildfire can also be an important restoration tool. All of these affect herbs, and herbs are well known to have an effect on the establishment of neighboring sagebrush. We've outplanted a lot of these different genotypes and provenances, young seedlings, into these treatments. Unfortunately, we did this in 2013 when there was very high mortality. We have detected some effects in which plots that have had, you know, a lot of reduction in herbs but then also were seeded do have somewhat different survivorship of our outplanted sagebrush. And so it does appear that how we treat the herb layer can have an impact on the success of the sagebrush that we might really be concerned about restoring to the landscape. So these common gardens are pointing out to us very high population variability, and that stresses such as wintertime effects can be more important than we've previously thought. Climate seed zones are definitely important according to the data that are coming in, although we still need to continue researching exactly which climate parameters to focus on, for example. And we need more inference from seedlings to know how what we think we know from adults could transfer to the restoration context when we're talking about young demographic stages. I want to point out that there's some new climate tools becoming available. Excuse the typo. Justin Welty is nearing an ability to release a new tool which will allow you to point at a map and bring up very resolute, informative information on the weather variability modeled for your particular point in space, like the site that you want to restore. So you can ask yourself, what is the climate of that area? There's not a lot of climate stations in the Great Basin or even perhaps across our four LCCs compared to areas like the East Coast or the Northeast U.S. And because of that, we have to do a lot more interpolation. Climate models can help in that regard, but unfortunately, they haven't really been able to look at like climate statistics, like you know, what are the chances of getting a frost of a particular magnitude for a pasture of or an allotment of interest that you're trying to work with. Well, these management tools are just, or these management decision support tools are soon to come online. One of those tools is the move to put seed zones up and available to seed collectors and also to the seed buyers to guide a more guided look at seed needs. Unfortunately, we don't have maps up yet available, seed zone transfer guideline maps for big sagebrush. Here's one developed for all species that might be considered for the Great Basin. Obviously, this is really just based on climate divisions, but you can expect over time to see the empirical seed zones by species become populated and more useful. So I'd like to finish up with telling you about some new directions, some things that I think are pretty exciting. Here's one that was motivated by Anna Halford. In the Birds of Prey, as well as a lot of the acreage in the Snake River Plain that has been affected by recurrent fires that have tended to exclude sagebrush, we've observed that the landscape has a loss of structure. You end up with these flat landscapes that no longer have tall perennial shrubs to create windbreaks or shade spots or to all, you know, create variability in moisture, which creates the opportunity for species we're trying to restore or species trying to naturally recruit to find their niche. So Anna commented once that she thinks the lack of shelter and wind shear that is now occurring in these sagebrush-less landscapes is probably something affecting the success of restoration plantings. And so we've been experimenting in manipulating wind, such as by using the straw wattle or snow fences, or even more exciting, I think, taking the sagebrush themselves and planting them in different density and different configurations so that the shrubs themselves can self and mutually ameliorate the microclimate, both for themselves, but more importantly, for a big target, which is to restore the whole perennial ecosystem to some extent. One other point, a lot of new research coming out on other techniques. Should we use seeds? Should we outplant? Should we bare root? Should we use containerized stock? How big should the containerized stock be? Should it have mycorrhizae or not? Where should we put our investment to get the best chance at beginning to see sagebrush restored to the landscape? Again, restoring sagebrush and its associated species is a huge element of restoration in the Western U.S. and Great Basin in particular. So we face some challenges. Conservation of restoration of big sagebrush, but there are opportunities because the human hand is pretty heavy on the big sagebrush, both in restoration as well as in things like fire control and planning our disturbances on the landscape. I hope that I've made a case that experiments are useful. These long-term experiments will be around for a long time, and they can serve as bellwethers or windows into what we might expect for particular species or communities. And this issue of diversity is sort of a thorn in our side. It complicates the story of how sagebrush responds to climate. But I do believe that within the time frame of years to decades, we'll increasingly have a better grasp on this and be able to better guide our restoration efforts. Long list of colleagues have made this research possible. The one that I think that I'm most excited about is the volunteers that have been made available to us through the leadership of Anna Halford and our colleagues in the Idaho Fish and Game. The problem of sagebrush covers a huge area. Restoring it is going to, the problems exist in a huge area. Restoring it is going to require widespread, well-dispersed efforts with a lot of hands. And the volunteer crew, I've come to realize, is essential. That's all I have. Not sure what we have for time for questions and how to proceed.
Thank you very much, Matt. very insightful, very informative, and something I think a lot of people overlook when they think about restoration. So I really appreciate the presentation. Viewers, now is the time to use the question box in your pop-out chat option there to give us some questions. Matt, I don't see any questions right now, but we'll give folks a few minutes here to furiously type away. I know we ran over a little bit, and I apologize for that. It was some technical difficulties, but I think I'm very happy we were able to handle them, and thanks for everyone's patience for considering this is the first in our series of webinars. They will get better. I'll remind everyone that all of the webinars will be recorded, so if you have colleagues that you'd like to point this webinar to, or any in the webinar series, go back to that wiki page, the one where you that you use to find out how to register for this webinar. So thanks again to Matt. I don't see any questions, Matt, but we'll give folks a minute here to type. Let me maybe ask one question to start with, and that is recognizing that that we are not at the place we are we're looking to be with the Carmen Garden type experiments and the issues associated with intraspecific variability. Is there any interim suggestion or recommendations we might give to managers considering a seed mix or what have you if they need to plant, let's say, following this year's fire season?
Well, I think we can support the idea that the more local, the better. Until we, because that is a long-standing paradigm that has been supported for a number of other species, both in semi-arid landscapes as well as other habitat types. The problem is when we know that we're undergoing rapid climate shifts, you know, when and where are we going to, and are we going to think about drawing seed sources perhaps from warmer and drier areas? That's a big question. So the simple answer to your question, Sean, I think is probably going with local is best. Secondly, maybe thinking a little bit more about how the climate of our sites, which again we can more quickly and readily get at, for example, when we're writing up an emergency rehabilitation proposal following fire, you can quickly get information on what the climate of your site is, and when you know what your seed sources are, you'll be able to better like look at those GPS points or perhaps the descriptions of where the geographic description of where the seed was from and see how it matches your site, to know that you're either drawing from a very similar climate in terms of things like winter harshness or you know, water deficit in the middle of the season, middle of summer. Notably, a lot of the seed sources have historically come ironically from higher elevations where seed is more abundant and easier to collect, more reliable to collect. You know, obviously trying to get away from that could be useful in the future. So those are some rough and ready guidelines, I think, that are they're fairly well implemented right now, I think.
Very good. Thanks, Matt. I don't see any other questions coming across. There were several messages of congratulations and appreciation, but nothing in the way of questions. So with that, okay, I guess we'll take you off the hot seat.
Great. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, too, Matt. And thanks, everyone, for joining. Again, look at the wiki site to see the recording here up in a week or so. And I remind everyone, next Tuesday, 1 o'clock Mountain Time, will be our next webinar, and it is discussing ecological minimums in sagegrass habitat requirements. So thanks, everyone, and for now, we're signing off.